Think you know what way it's going to go? Make your bet at Sports Interaction.
We're on the road to the Super Bowl, and Sports Interaction has you covered pregame, live betting on all major sports and prop bets.
Want to bet? Head to sportsinteraction.com/SDPN.
19 plus, please play responsibly.
She scores!
Take a moment to look up at the ceiling. You're about to bust through it.
SDPN, the PWHPA and Sports Interaction.
Wanna bet?
Presents Hockey, like you've never heard it before. The Knoxy and Kax Show, with Liz Knox and Karell Emard.
Let's get it, go!
Welcome back, Knoxy and Kax fans. We are back up to par this week. With Kax joining us, happy to have you back, buddy. How are you feeling?
I'm okay, I'm doing all right. Just a little couple of weeks of rehab and now I feel better, so I can sit down and actually endure a full hour with you. So that's why, you know, I didn't want to do it last week. I was like, it's not worth it. It's just Knoxy, whatever.
Yeah.
This week is way better. No, I'm kidding. I'm super pumped to be back, and then super pumped to have this one, just the two of us, and then update everyone and kind of get us going for the next little bit and couple weeks that we have upcoming with the P-Dub too. So this is exciting.
Hey. Kax had a little bump in her last game, but I'm glad to see that you're feeling a lot better now.
Yeah, I just got a bad little hit here and there, and it happens. And, you know, we'll see what comes out of it. But so far, so good. I'm stopped for 3 to 4 weeks. So I'll be watching hockey for the next little
while.
Always
good rehab is to come on the Knoxy and Kax Show, have a little laugh with your friends.
Exactly. You know what? I'll be able to listen to you while you're broadcasting and covering these games moving forward. So there's a plus.
We will get to that. We were this fucking close to getting Abby Rock on the show. Like, I'm telling you people, we had her lined up.
It was my fault. You know what? I'll take the blame before you go. I forgot to block one little part last night that she was available to come on the show. And I said, ooh, I can't. So it was my fault.
That's okay. My bad. The saga continues because we want Abby Rock. This is like kind of become a shtick for us now. It's like, we just want her on the show so bad. I called her out in the middle of a game, like when we were in Hollywood, being like, hey, when are you coming on the show? She's like, well, you never asked me. So first of all, but she will be on.
Yeah. Actually, everyone has been awesome and they want to be on this show. We just need to actually find time for them at this point. So our fault.
Kax and I are organized chaos.
Yeah.
Tell me about that.
We're not as bad as Skags, I would say, but we're hot messes here and there at times, balancing all of our schedules. That's all.
What's the thing from last year? Two bumbling idiots. Anyways, we're into February already. I don't know how. Like, the season has just flown by. So we're going to have a little one-on-one time, Kax and I. We're going to do a recap of our episodes, kind of with Izzy and Skags and Harmon and Brant. It was fantastic to have Harmon and Brant on. It was odd by myself, but
like, I was going to ask, and this is something that we could just touch on, but I want to know what people think of like the two on the show at a time type of deal.
Yeah.
Do we like it? Do we not? I want feedback on that too. I love having everyone, you know, at the same time. I think there's like a different vibe adding to it. Maybe less nervous.
They're like a little bit more comfortable. It's
You
can chirp each other. They kind of bring up each other's stories.
I was going to say, and you tell it. No, I will say it and stuff. So we see another angle. So I just, I'm curious to see what our fans like and not. And then maybe we can do it here and there, like one and then two and then one again.
Maybe we'll take the show on the road towards the end of the season.
I would love to do a live one.
A speed dating is what I'm thinking. Like, just rifle players in and out and you just ask them a couple questions.
I think we should. I think this would be a high vote yes from all of our people and our listener here. I will. Yeah, I'm in.
We're just spinballing ideas now, but we are going to get to some of our news updates. We're going to recap the standings and take a look at each of the teams using Kax with stats to kind of give you an idea, paint a picture really of what these teams are shaping up to be. I mean, we've had a good handful of showcases now, so we're starting to see some team identity form, and we'll go through that, and then we are going to remind you about the upcoming showcases. Of course, the most immediate one being our OHL weekend. So, let's go into a section that I've named that's news.
You are so creative, and I hope people appreciate what is happening. So love it. That's news. Liz, kick us off with the first news of the day.
Well, like I said, we're in February, which of course is Black History Month. And we're stoked to be amplifying Black voices, especially in the world of women's hockey and hockey at large.
Absolutely.
The Toronto International Film Festival debuted this film, Black Ice, which aired on TSN last night, Thursday night. It was at like 9 o'clock, so naturally I was in bed already. But you can catch it on Crave, so I'm super stoked to catch that film. Of course, our very own Sarah Nurse is in the film, along with our friend Blake Bolden and Soroy Tinker, who's been
doing incredible
work.
I know. I'm really excited to watch this one. And then that's been on the list and I was waiting for it. So I'm really excited. So you said it, and then I want to mention it again. It's on Crave in Canada. And I'm sure actually they can find it on any other platform. If not, TSN will probably replay it, because I've seen it and I've caught a couple documentaries on TSN Live and stuff like that. So yeah, give it a watch and let us know what you think. But I'm really excited about it.
And of course, like the premise of the documentary is that it kind of tracks or goes over the history of the Colored Hockey League of the Maritimes and of the early 20th century, and then the lingering history of anti-Black racism in the sport of ice hockey.
It's crazy.
And it's interesting because the PWHPA, actually, there was recently an article shared, written by Shireen Ahmed, good friend of the show, about the work that the PWHPA is doing with Dr. Courtney Seto. And Kax, you've sat in on some of these sessions. These are our anti-racism sessions, completely voluntary, but it's...
Yeah, I know. So every month, I think, or so, since, I want to say 2 years ago now, we've started these sessions, and Courtney has been just awesome. We spoke about her many times here on the show. Had her, you know, it's the work that she does to make us realize, you know, our normalities and sometimes how we are and how we see things, and just gives us a different perspective. And yeah, the article that was written by the CBC article, basically, can be found on the CBC.ca sports opinion, and then / you can find it there. I think I've grown as a human and as a woman, hockey player, just by, you know, sitting in these sessions and giving and understanding the perspectives that are coming from left and right. And, I love Courtney and the way she puts it for us. And then I love that we can actually put it into, you know, actions, by being there. And then what can we do? You know, like, it's always what we ask. It's one, get not like gain the knowledge, and two, what else can we do?
How do we activate this? Yeah,
exactly.
And it's really interesting because I was a sociology major in university at Sir Wilfrid Laurier. Got to shout him out. Great to be a Golden Hawk. But like, that was such an integral part of my education, was understanding, you know, oppression and racism and, you know, kind of all forms of diversity, how it operates or doesn't operate in our structures, you know, at an intimate level, at a structural level. And I think after college, after university, I kind of realized that like I took it for granted, because I was just like, oh, this is important things to learn to be a good member of society and help, you know, activate social change. And even if it's just in my little circle of women's hockey in the world, like, and then I kind of realized that like a lot of people didn't take courses like that. And again, I'm not saying you should be forced to do anything, but it's a really, like, we have to learn about history when we're growing up. We have to learn math. We have to learn science. Like, it's, the social studies is like, I think it's kind of like when you're in grade 6 or 7, whenever you start taking social studies, I think it's really like grazed over. I'm sure there's some, you know, much more educated people who can tell me that you know, what level you can tell a 12-year-old, like, to what extent we're going to talk about
racism. Exactly, right? Like, when are they open enough to this kind of knowledge?
But at the same time, like, empower everybody to understand our histories, and hopefully that inspires them to change, or to, you know, actively work to better the spaces that we occupy.
I couldn't agree more. And it also like depends on, you know, where you're from, small town, cities, like what kind of like people is around you. I grew up in a mini village of like five streets and, you know, farmers' lands and stuff. And I wasn't like really put into situation to understand these different perspectives and different ways of, you know, the oppression and everything that we've learned later on. And even then, I majored in psych. I didn't take social classes or anything in university. History was the max I did, you know, in high school, obviously. But just having the conversation, I was fortunate enough to have a assistant coach at St. Lawrence, Mayor McDougall, shout out to her, who has done an amazing work. I think her master's is in women's studies and social and stuff. And I should get the real thing that she did basically, but her ways of allowing us to have our own opinion, to ask questions, to learn about women, you know, empowerment in life and what have people have done before us. And even, I think her major was Black history as well too, or something. So she was like amazingly knowledgeable and just to come in her office and blur something and she'd be like, let's think this one through. And like, you know, you process things and then she's allowing you to develop as a woman and as a person on top of developing as a hockey player. If it wasn't for her, I don't think many of us at St. Lawrence would have had like a little bit of a well-rounded or knowledgeable type of brain coming out of there and seeing different perspective and understanding them too. It's not there for all. So I completely agree that people should probably learn that a little bit younger. I think it should be in our high school curriculum somehow.
And the way that Courtney Cito also, like her, I don't know, she's very relatable. She presents this information to the players. It's like Kax said, you know, it's an open discussion. Players are free to ask questions. We're learning. A lot of us are still learning. We're continuously learning. 100%. So it's like a good space to ask questions. And we're very grateful to her, all the work that she does. She's a Queen's University professor, of course. And since it's Black History Month, I wanted to also amplify the Black Girl Hockey Club, which I'm still trying to get my swag from, but it's okay. Not that they've been withholding. It's that, you know, at the time I was going to purchase, I heard, caught wind that they were moving to Canada. Of course, now they have BGHC Canada. So I've been contacting Soraya, our, you know, my good friend, and just being like, girl, set me up with some swag. Let's get this going. But you can go to their website, blackgirlhockeyclub.org. Take the Get Uncomfortable pledge to basically pledge, you know, anti-racism work in hockey, in women's hockey. You can donate there as well. Get gear. It's a great initiative and space organization to support this month, but every month of the year.
Absolutely. And Rupert was agreeing with you, and that's what we were hearing in the background saying, get on this website. No, he was pushing people there. It's okay. Get on the website. Absolutely. Go donate. That's something you can actually do right now in taking actions and helping. That's all. Like it can be as simple as that. Yep. Read a little. And go donate. Learn.
Love that.
You know?
Renee Hess, of course, too. Want to give her a big shout out. Founder of Black Girl Hockey Club. She's doing amazing things. And there's like almost not enough of her to go around. Everybody wants a piece of Black Girl Hockey Club, which is amazing to see. She's been working closely with NHL teams and just doing some incredible stuff in the hockey world. So we continue to do the work on our end and continue to learn and grow. We're committed to that.
Absolutely.
And moving on a little bit, the rivalry series rosters
coming to Quebec. And before you go there, coming to Quebec, it's going to be awesome too. And we want to give a shout out to one of our guests, is what you were about to
like a big
get pumped
quickly,
you know?
quickly becoming one of my favorite players in the PWHPA.
Okay, she had a sick weekend last weekend too. Sunday, she had a hat trick, I think, if I'm not mistaken, or had a couple goals, 100%, and was MVP of that game on Sunday, the game right before me, because we were watching. And I have to say, it was a blast to have her on the show.
Yes.
And it's a blast to kind of like get to see her like kill it on the ice, but even off ice, I'm like now paying attention a bit more to the outfit and paying attention a bit more to the, you know, attitude on the ice and everything, a little shove here and there. And You can say it now, but the rosters of the rivalry series came out and...
Well, if you haven't figured it out by now, Tatum Skaggs cracking finally the U.S. roster. I text her, she's been to every USA camp every year since she was 18 and has yet to crack the roster. So we're so stoked for her. It's going to be incredible. I know that, you know, she's been putting in the work. She's had a great season, as Kax said. She's a friend of ours, and we're just so happy to see her get this incredible opportunity at a time in her career. Like, you know, she's post-college. The best years may still be ahead of her.
Well, this is the thing. Like, the game has changed, too, a little bit. And the national programs are also seeing that, right? We've seen a couple exceptions in the mix and everything, maybe, like, getting called up, like, later on, like, Harmon, for instance, and stuff that if you didn't listen to the show, go and listen to it, guys. Hannah Brent and Savannah Harmon on that show that I missed was absolutely fabulous. But Skaggs version, she's playing amongst the best. She's pushing herself. They're seeing that. They're seeing that she's performing in this level. Well, why not bring her and see how, you know, how she's doing against. Yes, absolutely. And I think, you know, that's like, I don't know, but it just like to me, it's like, okay, people peak at different times, and this is another freaking situation where Hockey Canada and USA Hockey are stepping up. Oh, she's not part of the mold, but yet she may have made it, like, you know, and later on in life, or she's been crushing it at all levels, and maybe we should have given her a chance at some point. So, you know, props to you, Skaggs. We're pumped. We are pumped.
Way to go, Skaggs.
So, I'll be watching.
Course, those games, as Kax said, are in Quebec. Yeah.
Trois-Rivières, everyone. Trois-Rivières. Yeah.
That one is actually sold out.
Yeah,
so you can watch that one, I believe, on TSN RDS. And possibly
it's a little bit. Yeah, probably. It's a little bit of a smaller facilities, but it's where the East Coast, basically Habs team, the Lyon Trois-Rivières, are playing. So it's going to be a riot there. The fans are great. It's going to be amazing. I'm really pumped for the girls, for both teams. It's going to be, like you said, it's just sold out crowd. So it's always fun. And we are loud usually.
And then so. Game number 7 to round out the series, close out the rivalry series, Kax.
You got it. So it's Wednesday, February 22nd, and it's at Place Belle in Laval. So that's where the Les Canadiens used to play once in a while. So I don't know if you've been there.
I've been there.
Yeah, I think the big rink. So you've been to two, right? There's a Complex Bell, so that might be confusing, where you beat ass. Complex Bell is where you won. So just so you know.
Oh, no. Is that where Place Belle is the big guy?
Yeah. You got it.
We did.
So Place Belle is a fabulous rink. It's like the atmosphere there is sick on its own. We played there with big crowds, smaller crowds, and it was sweet. I'm really pumped for them. So that's at 7 p.m. on the Wednesday. I know my friends are all like still trying to get tickets and everything. So it's going to be another great game. Please don't hurt Rupert. Okay. And just so you keep going and, you know, taking care of Rupert here, it's 3-2. US is leading Canada 3-2 in that series too. So it finished up on a good note for Canada. I'm looking forward to see what the girls are doing here in Quebec, and it's gonna be, I just can't wait. It's gonna be loud, it's gonna be good games, and
they've all been so close. We've had two of those five games already go into overtime, so
I know
I'm with you. I'm excited to see how this rounds out. Gonna be some good hockey, so definitely check that out. And currently going on the PWHPA, we've got five players at the NHL All-Star weekend. So we've got Alex Carpenter, Hillary Knight, Emily Clark, Rebecca Johnston, and Sarah Nurse currently in Miami.
Yeah, yesterday we saw a couple of tweets, a couple of things going on. There's a little bit of a chal comp. So Canada took U.S. and they did win. A little Clarky Nurse versus Knighter Carpenter type of deal for, I think it was PlayStation. I don't even know, but NHL 2023.
They're gaming.
They were gaming. So that's like the first little thing that they had. And then obviously there's a couple other things. And I want you to talk to me about this goalie, cool, really type of skills. I don't even know what to call it. The 8 goaltender that will be participating in that. Is it Tandy Tandem? Is that what it is?
Tandy Tandem. Okay. Let's talk about it. Brought to you by Discover. So this is a new event, I believe. It's 8 goaltenders participating in the event, with one goalie from each division designated the shooting goalie and one the in-net goalie. So the shooting goalies will earn points based on the accuracy of their shots at the net. This is something I feel like I would have excelled at because...
Okay, wait, time out. You're in the slot and you're taking a shot on the goalie? Is
that's
that what's happening?
That's how I imagine it. Yes.
Okay, good. I just need to picture it.
So like an accuracy
it.
Shooting, but for goaltenders. Yeah, yeah. This is how I'm picturing it anyways, based on the description. I've
Don't
never seen
us.
This done before, so
Don't
I could be
us on
way
it,
off. They could be in the net passing to... It may be a passing target. I don't know. So
yeah, I'm not
we'll
sure.
have to tune in and see. But
all right.
Regardless, I would have fucking crushed that because I was always better at playing the puck than I was at stopping it. So that part, I got locked. And then the in-net goalie, in a series of passing, then the in-net goalie has to face a rush of 2, 3, or 1 player. So either a breakaway, 2-on-0, 3-on-0. And then that's based on the number of points that they earn by the shooting goalie. So this is like way too much complication for most goalies' brains, but we're going to tune in and see how it works out. And our women, our PWHPA athletes, will be the shooters for either 1-on-0, 2-on-0, 3-on-0. So it's going to be exciting.
See some tic-tac-toe goals here.
And we were saying like, okay, granted, now they've been down there, I'm sure they'll get like a little bit of on-ice time. I'm sure these players are going to be planning like, what are we going to do? Like, you got to go into this kind of on the same page, right? We were talking before we started recording about Kendall Coyne Schofield skating the fastest lap. Kax, tell us, you know, kind of about the build up to this moment that she didn't even know she was going to be in.
Yeah. So like I was, we were chatting and that's like what, 4 years ago now or three, at least three anyways, but she got a phone call and it was like, just, hey, could you come? Someone got hurt, in the fastest skater. And then they thought of potentially like, bringing a girl or a woman to go skate. And then would you come and do like the fastest lap? Let's like do it. And she's like, I'm like, yes, sure. Like, and was kind of asking questions to her agent and then who should like whatever. And then they put her on a flight. She got there and she got there last minute ish or the day before or something, potentially did a lap the night before. And then her skates weren't sharpened. There's nothing really happening. And then she didn't even warm up before. Like, you know, like I was thinking like, maybe she did an active warm up out of the ice, but
couple
you're gonna have
to
take a freaking
go.
Yeah, something like that. And she just goes, and you know, now it's like announced that day she's going to do the lab, she's going to do the demo, everything. Like, there's no really like a plan for women's hockey to be involved in this All-Star edition, and she just sits on that like red line, blue line, and then I was like, what was the like, how did you feel? She's like, honestly, I think I blacked out. Like, it was like, like the nerves and everything. And I'm just like picturing herself. First of all, you know, you're not really like fully warmed up. 1, 2, your equipment is like maybe shitty. Hopefully you don't cross over, hit the boards or, you know, fell off. And then you're performing this thing in front of like thousands of people, thousands of thousands of people. And she's like, and I knew I needed to do well. Like I knew. So like what we were saying is that she just showed up, did it, killed it, crushed it, beat guys, right? And those are like 5 of the fastest men in the NHL. And she's amongst them, right? So she's beating a lot of other people in the 31 teams that exist. Let's put it this way. And the pressure that she put on herself to do it, like, what if she failed? You know what I mean?
No.
Like what if she failed? And then we have this, I'm going to be rude for a hot sec, but I get this beautiful commenters like typing on the keyboard saying to go back to her kitchen and all that jazz. Like I got when I took a penalty and that was my normal habitat that you made comments on. Like it would have been, she knew that if she failed, there is nothing that would, you know, help us in the future. She had to kill it.
Yeah.
And because she killed it, now we're having 5 other girls doing something different because this is the third time that we're having, you know, different scenarios with the NHL All-Star Games. We've had the first time it was like just demoing. We had Deckard. I was there. Hillary Knight, Megan Duggan, a bunch of the Americans were there to show. Then we had a full on game, right?
Yeah, they kind
Remember?
Of just like sprinkle the women in.
Yeah.
But that and then moment. Like, I would agree. Is in, and whether she knew the magnitude of it or not, is like, that was a turning point in women's hockey history, honestly.
Yeah.
And then she goes on, like, Kendall Coyne, for those that don't know, is the president of our Players Association. So yeah. she writes a book, Fast as Her, which, you know, I'm sure some of our listeners have read. If not, definitely pick up a copy, come to a PA showcase, get it autographed. She writes a book basically about that moment, what the weight that carried and how it changed the way that the general population looked at women's hockey. Then she takes on a president's role with the PWHPA while she's working for the Chicago Blackhawks.
Yeah.
And of course,
she was broadcasting too. I'm pretty sure in between the glass, at the bench level.
Yeah. And like she has a number of organizations that they run through the Schofield Family Foundation.
Yeah.
They opened a park in her name.
While she's an owner of the, Chicago Red Star there. And
an absolutely incredible, incredible human being. And actually, it's funny enough, I texted her yesterday, was like, hey, on a whim, you want to come on the podcast tomorrow? she's booked months in advance. And I was like, hey, what are you doing tomorrow morning?
I think honestly, we need to get her on it. I think it's people need to hear how much she does. Like you just rumble it. And I think it's the first time that people actually hear how much she does for us and her knowledge on, she is a co-owner with her husband of, and other owners, obviously, NWSL. But the knowledge that they both bring for, contract player, rep, everything that comes around from an NFL standpoint, from an NWSL standpoint, from her own experience with USA Hockey, it is so impressive. And, to have her leading our way, I couldn't be more, calm to sit behind these people and be like, yeah, yes. And even super open for suggestion or recommendations or anything too. And at times, I didn't think of that. Yeah, that's a great point. We should absolutely do this. And really truthfully has the players' needs, at heart.
And honestly, the best part was she considered it. She's like, how long does an episode take? I was like, oh, normally an hour to an hour and 15. She's like, ooh, yeah, I just don't have an hour before my next call. I was like, I was fully expecting just boom, my ghosted, God. Not going to talk to you at all. Knoxy, what the hell are you thinking? But I do think that if we plan well enough in advance, we can get,
her on the road.
And you guys will love her as much as we do because, as Kax is saying, she's just a fantastic person. So all that, PWHPA at All-Star Weekend, that's how we got on that topic. Ooh, I did want to talk about tickets. So we have OHL Weekend coming up, and I have to apologize because...
Explain to us.
For three or four weeks, I've been like, go to, OHL.com and find their team and then buy the tickets. And the Peterborough tickets have been a little bit of a journey, let's say. And that's nothing
against
a nice
way to put it.
The organization or anybody that's working hard for us. It's just, this is a school buyout game. So initially the tickets went to the schools. It's going to be a fantastic game. It's at 11 a.m. Kristen Richards, her girls hockey team that she coaches at De La Salle College, is making a trip to Peterborough to come watch her play. So
shout
I want to just throw
out.
That in because she's pumped that her students are there. They obviously love her. She's a fantastic coach. So it's cool. That's a school day game. It's kind of schools, teachers. We got Carolyn Prevo, Shay Tiley, Kristen Richards, Victoria Box in Teachers College. We have so many people in that network that are either planning to become teachers or, post-playing career. That's what they want to do. So, and all of us, I'm sure, had great teachers growing up. So to have a school day game is awesome. Back to the tickets. I fucked up. Okay. So I was telling you to go to the website. Our Instagram link is correct. So you can get Peterborough tickets, Gen Pop now, as I call it, Gen Pop tickets, through our Instagram link, or you can go to gopetesgo.com, follow through tickets, search single game tickets, buy online. There's a little hyperlink. It'll take you to the Grant Thornton box office. And then in the search bar, you search PWHPA, then you buy. Or just go to the Instagram
link.
And click the link. You can get tickets. It's a lot simpler now. But our website is being updated. So that link on our website on the pwhpa.com is being updated. I'm sure that will be updated by the time this airs. But in the event that it's not and it takes you back to the school day page, just go to Instagram. You can get tickets there. It's going to be a great day.
There you go.
And then
link in the bio.
This
click
is like,
on it.
Yeah.
Buy your tickets.
Yeah,
show up.
I don't know. I'm not like an IT
specialist.
That's
how simple it should be, right?
I don't write code. Jeez. I don't know how to do this. The last
Ooh.
Thing in our news item, Kax.
Ooh.
And that's
Are you
news.
Excited?
It's the final showcase. Wow.
Hey, we didn't even plan this. I just have to say, I didn't really plan on singing. Were you?
I see a band in our future.
Yeah, we should. You know what? We have angel voices. So
Insert
absolutely.
Cricket sound here. Yes, there will be a final showcase that we have yet to announce. I'm like,
then we can't do it today. Can
we can't. I want to, but we can't. The players have known about this. It
yes.
is extremely exciting. The players are pumped. Huge, massive, gargantuan, epic announcement of our final showcase location. Ugh, I wish I could scream it from the rooftops right now, but.
I will say from a player standpoint, you said it. We're fucking pumped about this one. If
yeah.
I can say that one.
You can.
We've been pumped about every single one that we've been announcing since January. But yeah, the final one, you know, it makes that little like
Might
intensity
be the last
higher.
One.
Maybe the last one in terms of like the secret grab tour thing, history made or not. Like, you know, it's
it feels like a pretty epic, honestly, event. And yeah, a lot of work. A lot of work has gone into these last 4 years. And I'm excited. I'm excited. You should be too. Stay tuned. Next week, the PWHPA will be announcing that location. And you are not going to want to miss a single second of that.
So I started taking AG1 as part of my morning routine. And as someone who's always on the go and trying to get the right nutrition is something that I've struggled with for years. But AG1 honestly makes it so convenient. Like one scoop in the morning, it's all your health products in one. I just have my AG1, my coffee, and I'm ready to go. By far the easiest habit I've added to my daily routine in 2023.
So I love it. I love it because it helps me to know that I'm hitting my vitamins and my greens intakes daily. I also feel phenomenal physically. I have more energy for the gym, for my workday, and even for practices whenever I have them during the week. I also love to start the new year with some goals. We spoke about it to keep that kind of like in the focus of like self-care, self-help. And AG1 is helping me have a healthier lifestyle right now. And my routine is easy to keep. I'm telling you, this one is a guaranteed achievable goal for this year and a new healthy habit I will keep for sure moving forward. So I love it. Thank you, AG1.
If a comprehensive solution is what you need from your supplement routine, then Athletic Greens is giving you a free 1-year supply of vitamin D and 5 free travel packs with your first purchase. Go to athleticgreens.com/TKKS. That's athleticgreens.com/TKKS. Check it out.
We will get to kind of highlighting all of our upcoming showcases after we take a look at standings. So first of all, we'll go to the tour leader. No surprise to anybody that's been following the Secret Dream Gap Tour. Team Harvey's is just like pulling away in front. Of course, Kax plays on Team Harvey's, so she's got a biased opinion here. But 27 points. Tell us a little bit about your team and
so
why you guys are so freaking good other than
will. You know what? We have a... I don't know what the attitudes are on the other team in the locker room. Everyone's getting along. I will say that. Everyone's having a blast in any of the teams that were, you know, part of in this year's showcase. And they love the concept of mixing everyone from everywhere. I will say that for Harvey's, in a sense, we have been chirped for having meetings on Thursday night before showcases or for having video session or for having, you know, a little bit of a concept for, you know, follow this, follow that. Or when in doubt, here are the, you know, 2-3 things that you should do and you should expect your line mate to do or your defenseman to do in these areas. So as a whole, I said it, we have good people in all the teams. I love my teammates. They're awesome. On top of it, we have a great staff, led by Corey, Chevry. And I think that her experience on, you know, coaching teams, like Hockey Canada that are made on this, on the fly, basically, or you have your team for a season, but you don't necessarily train them all year long, may have advantaged her a little bit in terms of how to deal with us. So Harvey's just killing
how
it.
How to deal with you is the perfect way to put it.
And Harvey's killing it because we have great freaking players, amazing goaltenders. I will say that both of them have been playing awesome. Boss is going to perform a bit more in Tampa. I'm excited to see her out there. And this weekend and in the GTA weekends as well, too. We'll see that our three goalies were sick and have been sick since Karell, and you know that. And then our coaches have just been killing it. Hey, here are the three things you should focus on. Here's what you need to do.
So
here's
a good game plan. A good game plan. Amazing. Goes a long
I will say that. And
albeit,
I just think everyone's buying it. Let's be honest.
I was just going to say, albeit, like, I don't know. I'm not in the Scotiabank Sonnet Adidas dressing room, so I don't know what information they're getting. We know what you're getting. So if it's working, then don't change it. And you said, okay, so you got Poo and Eldridge, who are in the two of the top five.
Top five.
In scoring. Both played 11 games. Poo's got 15 points and Eldridge with 12. So that's really going to help your team.
It does. It does.
And also in that leaderboard, though, Rebecca Johnson has 17 points. She's leading the league right now. 17 points in 11 games. That's absolutely insane. 9 goals, 8 assists. And then rounding out that top five, Blair Turnbull with 12 points in 11 games. So tied with Jesse Eldridge. So there, it's no surprise based on that information, obviously, that they've had a very competitive season, but they're actually sitting in third place right now. So let's talk a little bit about Scotiabank. You know, they've got scoring leaders.
Yeah.
But when you look at the kind of the scoring leaderboard, that it's kind of quiet until you get down to Megan Keller's, you know, in sitting in 12th. Kelly Panic's up there. And then, you know, it kind of tapers off into Bourbonnais, Daou, Shelton. A lot of defense actually racking up some points on Scotiabank.
I was going to say, I think they're getting a lot of help from that area. I, you know, in terms of like how Scotiabank is, you said it, like, again, another team with Emrin Smashmeyer and Soupy Kimball in the back there. They were faced, I will say, by probably the, I think I saw it, like, I did it, I don't remember what show, but we did a little bit of a thing. They faced the most slot shots. So shots coming from the danger zone. So I think that although the points are coming from their defensemen and the points are coming, you know, a lot, you know, Rebecca had great games. I think Skaggs had a good games and she's on that, that team as well, too. Sometimes defensively, I think we're running into a little bit of a pickle on who takes who and, you know, passes to the danger zones that are being allowed maybe here and there. But that's it. Like other than that, that team has been creating a ton of scoring chances. They're dangerous. Every time we play them, it's like, you know, back and forth and it's like offense, offense, offense.
Well,
and it makes sense.
And I think,
you know,
interestingly, like the Scotiabank D, because they're so active offensively, like at times, maybe it's burning them on the other side, right? Like, cause you're getting four players jumping into the rush.
Exactly.
And these teams are so quick in their transition game. Like I noticed it, especially in the, oh gosh, now I'm trying to remember who played on the Sunday. It was a whirlwind.
It was Scotiabank versus Sonnet and then Adidas versus Harvey's. We both played on Sunday. So
yeah, and I believe it was a Scotiabank Sonnet game where it was L. Shelton, like, was almost always, you know, either three on the offensive triangle or coming in as that second or third wave jumping into the play. Like between Shelton, Keller, like these defense like to get into the play. And you know, that's kind of a risk you take. You try to create offense. Sometimes it, you know, turns around at the other end just because the transition game is so fast, but
exactly.
They're only 1 point behind. So Scotiabank, Harvey's in first, Scotiabank in third, And Scotiabank is only 1 point behind Team Adidas. And Team Adidas and Scotiabank, I think, are so similar.
Yeah.
Perhaps not in how they generate their chances, but like Adidas defense, like they're so good. They're very offensive as well.
I will say that Adidas, like, so the difference between the two in terms of scoring chances is like a lot more is created off like forecheck situation in Scotiabank or ozone play.
Yes.
Ozone play. And then clearly Adidas is like power is from the rush. So you get two teams that are, they're so fast, right? With Stace, Candle, Coyne, O'Neill, Sonia, like name them. They're all like going at a different speed.
Yeah.
And Nersi, like everyone's just going and joining and stuff. And so, you know, that's the main difference. I will say that like Adidas is trying to generate as much as they can off the rush. So it's a one and done or one recover, try to get again at the net versus Scotiabank can spend a lot of time in their ear zone. So they're tiring the other team. They're like possessing, they're doing a lot. And that's what Sonnet is like too, to me as well too, playing against them. They're also tough. There's like lines, just like, you know, Abby Rock is dangerous. We're going to get her on the show. I get it, but she is always dangerous. And then you have, you know, I think they had Brent, Skorupa and Niter playing together last showcase because Haley Skorupa is now part of the whole group, and that line was dangerous. Then you had Abby with her line. I think Vasco was playing on her left wing or right wing, and then I'm forgetting the other line, mate. God. Anyways, another stud that I can't remember her name, obviously for some stupid reason. But those two lines on each teams are generating so much. And then not only will I, the third line and fourth line of every single team can actually play against any lines one or two or whatever, and then shut them down too.
Well, I was
so like,
say,
you've got like true defensive abilities and offensive abilities in all teams. And it's just a matter of like, you know, who's going to be more on in terms of like opening up the danger zone in your D zone or not, or blocking that stuff. So you get a puck in the middle. What do you do with it?
Right.
Put them to the side, right? Do the roll, like the stuff. Don't try to deke. And sometimes that's what happens. It's like a D wants to go or shoots it in the middle, and then you generate another shot against you and stuff like that. So it's the little details that actually make the biggest difference defensively, I think. I think that's what's been happening maybe with Sonnet, and where they can generate so much offensively. But then, you know, there's like, Aaron Ambrose was hurt too and wasn't playing, so you're losing a couple D there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just excited to see what's going to happen too between Scotiabank and Adidas, seeing who's finishing 2 and 3.
Right.
And then it's just maybe an advantage in the last showcase, potentially. I don't know. We don't know where the standing will go, you know?
Well, I talked a little bit with it about it with Hannah Brandt. Of course, she's on Sonnet.
Yeah.
And like, they have all the pieces. Like, they have the pieces they need to be, you know, a real contender. And they are a threat to play against. I mean, we said it before, we'll say it again. The Harvey Sonnet matchup is like one of the most entertaining matchups that we've seen this year.
Yeah.
And it's just that Harvey's just seems to have that extra it factor when it comes down, games on the line. That, you know, they just seem to be able to pull away in the dying minutes or, you know, in the third period or in overtime. But Sonnet is right there. I mean, I think that this is a team that cannot be underestimated, because as the season goes on and they just, you know, kind of become a little bit more comfortable in their identity, you know, they can hang with the top teams as well. And to that point, I mean, I think that defensively they have to play a different structure than a Team Adidas. Let's say we just talked about Team Adidas speed up front. I mean, they can play,
You have Jocelyn fast there,
right,
too, on top of it.
Like, and they can play a very, like, crash bang, tons of pressure in their zone. Like, if they get exposed, they have the foot speed to get back into position or to pick a man up. But I think Sonnet, on the other side of things, and it's not a knock on them, but strategically, I would be playing a lot closer and let other teams play on the outside. You know what I mean? Like, eliminate the in-house chances, eliminate those slot shot opportunities. And
absolutely.
When you get the puck, when you get that transition, then you have the energy to have an odd man rush the other way. And with, you know, Hillary Knight, Hannah Brandt, Abby Rock, like very heavy American offensive prowess on this team, not to knock the other players, but you get those chances, like you got to bury. right? Like, because you're only going to get them maybe 5-6 times a game.
I know.
And that's my tip.
It's a good tip. I think it is. And then keep it simple. Take it out. You know, like sometimes we're trying to maybe tread a long pass a lot or too much, and, you know, bringing it into a rush for them may help. Anyways, in terms of attacking with like five and being a threat, because they are, every time they come in, I'm like, oh boy, like,
yeah. Oh yeah,
this could go in our net 100%. Like
Rock,
they have the talent.
I'm not sure if you mentioned it already, but Abby Rock is sitting third right now in points.
Yeah.
13 points in 11 games. She's the only Team Sonic player in the top five. Well, as we said, the saga continues. We're going to have her on the podcast very, very soon. But like you say, you find somebody that can finish like that, and you just got to ride that momentum, right?
Exactly. And then I think Jenner is on the verge, and if not, like, we'll climb up the stuff. She had a good weekend too, and, you know, things will get like going. And this Jenner is dangerous.
Yeah, Jenner's dangerous, a top 10 points getter. Like,
yeah. And then, so, you know, having all those girls kind of connect together, like, I mean, like, it's the top five for like Sonnet right now, in terms of like, it's, you know, Jenner is in it, Abby Rock is in it, Vasco is in it, Anna Brandt, you know, and then we'll see like Hillary Knight and then the other ones. So they're all like in the top 15, 20 in terms of like how it goes and what will change. And I'm excited to see what they always say, like, it's okay, we'll play when it fully matters. So like a playoff team type of vibe.
Same,
you know? So I'll hear it. I'll keep listening and see how it goes, you know?
Yeah. Exactly. And
I love it.
We did want to get to some of our upcoming showcase reminders. So we touched a little bit on Peterborough, which is Friday, February 10th. That's next Friday, which is crazy. You got Harvey's and Scotiabank in Peterborough, 11 a.m. On February 10th in Niagara, hosted by the Niagara Ice Dogs. You've got Team Adidas and Team Sonnet at 7 p.m.
Yes.
And then take us to Saturday.
Saturday, February 11, at 1 p.m., we'll have Adidas playing against Harvey's in Barrie, Ontario. You know, we're trying to put players in their hometowns, and that's one for sure for Jesse Eldridge in Barrie. And then the Saturday game, Sonnet, we've got a couple people from St. Catharines area, Niagara. So go see your hometown players and hero type of thing. February 11, so again, 11, we have Adidas versus Harvey's at 1 p.m. in Barrie, and then we have Sonnet versus Scotiabank at 6 p.m. in Kitchener, hosted by the Kitchener Rangers there in the OHL. And then the Barrie, I'm forgetting, it's Colts. I should have known. Jesse posted something yesterday, her favorite team of all time and stuff, and she's been to a lot of the games. So I'm very excited for all of our players to be playing in the GTA. And thank you to the OHL teams for stepping up, you know, and making this weekend such a good one for all the little girls and boys and families that want to come out and come and watch us. Anyone that's a big fan of hockey, we want you in those rinks.
And you can join our broadcast.
Let's talk about this
Izzy Germain on the play-by-play and yours truly on the color in what I'm calling the Izzy and Knoxy Broadcast Roadshow, because we are hitting four cities, four different games in 2 days. It's going to be an absolute whirlwind. And
it's going to be amazing.
I
think they should put a camera.
So good on Saturday night.
I think they need to put a camera on your cars and just seeing like, okay, now we're switching. Okay, Adidas Sonnet, let's go. Let's get the vibe.
Genuinely,
here. We're going.
Yeah, I think that it could be like an amazing race vibe where like you're seeing us in the back of a car being like, okay, what are we going to talk about this game? Who are we looking at? What are the stats? This, that.
Like,
you know, there's a
like
lot.
Like, for people to understand, like, you're going from Peterborough to Niagara.
Yeah.
Then you're done for the day. That's messed up right there. And then you're going from Barrie to Kitchener. Like, you're not having easy runs.
And
like,
you know what? If you are somewhat of a religious person or a faith, you know, faith-based person, spiritual even, your thoughts and prayers are greatly appreciated that we don't hit any traffic or snowstorms or car issues. Like, this is going to be, this is going to take a Christmas miracle.
This was funny. And let's talk about this too, because I think it's funny when we had a player rep call too.
It's funny? That's great, Kat.
It's funny for you and everything, but it's also funny for we have Americans, we have people from everywhere. We have like, where's Peterborough? I don't fucking know, right? Like they don't know, whatever. Like that's how they think, right? And we had Nursey saying to all the player reps in our call, guys, I have one thing to add. Let's just make sure all of our players are well aware that there will be some driving. And then she just paused and she's like, we're sleeping in Toronto. Let's be honest here. We're all at a hotel in Toronto. There's going to be an hour or two's at time to go to games and to come back. Let's just make sure our players are aware of that, you know, and let's just be okay and very clear. And then she paused and everyone's like, oh yeah. She's like, no, let's make sure. Let's make sure everyone from California, from everyone. I was like, Nursey, I think we got it.
Okay. I have a question for you. What is your go-to? This is impromptu, but what is your go-to like bus? You have like, let's say you have like a 6 hour or 8 hour road trip. What are you doing on the bus, Kax?
6 hour road trip. I would go back to college. Obviously we had movies and stuff like that and chatting, but on my way there, I think, I for sure watch a movie or something or a show. I have that on my iPad. It's gotta be. And then, chat. I will be a chatting person. Yeah. You know, I'll sit with, catch up with whoever's awake. And then if no one's awake, I force myself to try to nap, but it's more so me staring on my eyelids the whole time because I can't freaking nap on these buses. Back in college, I wouldn't do work. I don't know if you did work or whatever you did back then, but not one of those.
I barely did work at a desk, let alone on a bus. That ain't happening. Yeah.
To go to places is tougher. C-Dub, when we were coming back from places, we knew what we were doing. You know, back at the bus table was there, a couple of drinks, maybe.
Couple brews.
Celebrating the wins and stuff. And then, true pro hockey.
I didn't have level. Many celebrating wins, but we drank anyways. Did. Win or lose, Shut we it. Booze. That was our motto.
But, well, our drives were everywhere. Like drive to Markham, drive to Toronto, drive to Boston, or fly to Calgary. Yes. My favorite trip, and I will put Charlene Labonte on the spot right now, and I'm sorry for it, but my favorite road trip of all time was coming back from Calgary in the plane. And we're all like, I'm sitting beside Pooh and other people. And then the lady comes down and she's like, oh, drinks or whatever. I'm like, I'll have a Sprite. Like, it's okay. And then Pooh's like, oh, I'll have a water and whatever. And then we hear, I'll have a rum and Coke. Then we turn.
Yes.
And I'm like, Charlie? She goes, why not? So we're all like, okay, we'll have a rum and Coke. We emptied the bar. The empty little, like the plain bar. We emptied it of rum. There's no rum.
Oh,
they had
gosh.
To refill the thing because the team just got after it a little bit because Charlie is not a drinker. Like she'll participate here and there, but that day she felt like having a rum.
Yeah. And that was really rally the girls to be like, all right, guess we're doing this.
We both looked at each other and just said, make it double.
we were coming back from Calgary one time as well. The flight attendant came by and he was like, oh, like you guys must be a hockey team or something, right? Like we all, you know, a group of hockey players.
We do look like a sports team or something.
Fucking obvious. Anyways, he's like, oh, you guys, you know, you're the hockey team, soccer team. Like, what are you? We're like, oh yeah, we're hockey team. He's like, oh, cool. Like what league is it? And we said the Canadian Women's Hockey League. And him being like probably somewhat familiar with women's hockey, but not familiar, I think he thought we were like the Canadian Olympic team. And he was like, you guys want anything? You just let me know. We're on a WestJet flight. You guys want drinks? All good. I got you. Like, I'll keep you guys supplied the whole flight. So our Markham Thunder team, who's very much, I shouldn't say very much not, but like the vast majority of us are not the national team. The Funda. Yeah. The Markham Funda. We're like, Adam, keep the beers coming. Whatever his name was. And like, holy smokes, like, girls were landing in Toronto being like, how are we getting home? Like, we got to get Ubers now. Like, we just got absolutely lit. But it was awesome. Like, hey, somebody's going to offer me free drinks. I'm like, no.
The unprep, like, not planned type of, like, tipsy drinking times.
Yeah.
Those are my faves. Yeah. I'll say that.
Exactly.
Welcome to Knoxy and Kaxi's little reminiscing moment here about the C-Dub and the fun times we had.
And Let's if you want to think about a good time, there's probably no better time than Tampa. February 24th to 26th, Wesley Chapel, Florida.
Book your vacation and get to Wesley Chapel. It's a nice little facility, USA Hockey stuff there. Yeah, it'll be fun. I'm excited.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome. Happy to see the girls going to somewhat of a warmer climate, especially when we're in this cold snap right now, because just walk outside, okay. You can't feel your face.
Not okay.
And then after that, March 4th and 5th, we are back in Washington. Cannot say enough good things about the Washington Capitals organization.
Mm-hmm.
Professionalism that they treat us with. You know, I'll say this till I'm blue in the face. This is one of my favorite stops last year. Probably
you're
my
biased.
Favorite.
Oh, you're biased. Gosh.
And I can't wait to go back. I took a vacation day just so I could go back. March 4th.
That's amazing.
MedStar Capitals Iceplex. Can't wait to see that gang again. Peter, Jesse, all the fantastic people there. And mystery location. You thought I was going to say it, didn't you?
But you kind of know that it's going to be in March. That's what you kind of know about. And you kind of know that, you know, we might or may not have playoffs. Who knows? So
it's going to be awesome. Cannot wait for that announcement. Stay tuned this coming week. I'm sure it will be, you know, early to mid next week. So like the 5th, 7th, somewhere in there. 5th,
7th. So again, this upcoming weekend, we have our GTA type of like weekend. Tampa is next in February 24th, 26th. Washington, and then mystery. So
mystery.
We're gonna be busy, but
mystery Alaska.
Freaking awesome! Oh, that's a good movie. It's a great movie. It's a great movie.
Spoiler.
Yeah.
Yeah, and as always, you can keep up with
the Hickles are hosting us. Actually, you know what? The Hickles are hosting us in Alaska. We're gonna go and hike. Their lives are great. I wish we should get those two on the pod as well too.
The Hickle sisters,
Zoe. Yeah, and Tori.
Yeah. Great hockey players.
Okay, sorry. Go ahead, Knoxy. I cut you
it's
off.
It's okay. I'll just round it out by saying, as always, you can keep up with the Knoxy and Kax Show by following us at SDPN Sports on Instagram and Twitter. And you can stay up to date with PWHPA at pwhpa.com or on social at PWHPA. Tune in next Friday to see if we've managed to get Abby Rock on the show. This is like Carmen Sandiego.
No. Well, this is tough because it's Terry's coming too. So we're going to have to like get this thing done. So stay tuned, people.
Oh, God. We're sorry, Abby. And sorry, fans. But we will get her. We're determined. That's all for this week's episode. Thank you so much, Kax. And we're glad to have you back.
Absolutely. I'm glad to be here. Thank you, everyone. Knoxy, have a good day, girl.
See you next week.
The Knoxy and Kax Show on SDPN, produced in partnership with the PWHPA and presented by Sports Interaction.
Want to bet?
Follow Knoxy and Kax on Twitter at 27Knoxy and at Karell Mard. The views expressed are those of the individuals and are not necessarily those of the PWHPA. Check out sdpn.ca for more Knoxy and Kax and the rest of the SDPN crew.
She scores!